I pursue in structural engineering, and I would like to share some of the key points with you guys so that you can also get a glimpse of what all is expected of a structural engineer as a profession. Look at it as a very good career going forward. As you see the first slide of the presentation, there are a lot of small fonts that are popping out of the screen at every corner of the screen, and then that is pretty much what we as a structural engineer have to do. Are into the profession, right? What you see, the image on the screen is basically the tall buildings from Dubai. And I think it is where it all started, like, you know, fascinating about the tall buildings, fascinating about the construction industry and the tall buildings, and also very closely attached to it, the structural engineering. Frankly speaking, the fascination of building things is not new to human. As a two-year child also gets, you know, those building blocks, and then, you know, they build up a lot many things just by their imagination without seeing so many things. So, but they don't know how these things will stand up. And that is where the fascination turns into a profession as you grow old. And then we start building up the bigger building blocks, and then start building up the bigger things. Some of these are buildings, some of these are bridges and certain things, everything of that sort. So moving on, I will be covering majorly into this presentation. I will go to the current industry trends and current market conditions, so that you will also understand how much scope is in the industries there is in the structure. And then we will also cover the different fields where the structural engineering profession is required. What are the challenges of each of these fields, and what are the expertise that you would require as a structural engineer? So that I will be covering. And then I would like to typically go on talking about the things rather than writing on the slides. So please bear with me and write out the questions for the end sessions that you can ask me freely. And the fourth topic that I want to really cover is the challenges of human-occupied buildings, because you would learn a lot of topics in the structural engineering about the strength of the materials, how the loads and everything is calculated and all sorts of things, but nobody will talk about what are the challenges that you would see of a human-occupied building, right? And this is because every human is different, everybody's needs are different. And that creates a lot of problems. While I am talking about the different fields where the engineering is required, I will also be covering smaller portions, each of these fields where the challenges come up. And definitely the last but not the least, what are the educational requirements that you would have to possess to get this profession? So I will just see the history of the structural engineering. I will just show you how it moved on. So basically, if you look at the slide, it is very clear that it all started in 2700 BC. One of the biggest structure was built up, and this is the pyramid. It is still standing. And I gave you an example of a two-year-old with the building blocks. It's exactly the same thing. These are the building blocks. They were placed one above the other, and a pyramid was created, right? Not much of a knowledge of the stability of these things was required. And in 1000 BC, what we see is a Connaught water management system. This is actually an underground channel that was built up in Iran to get the water supply to different parts of the country. And it's the longest sort of a canal system at that time. And it was underground. If you see after that, there's a large period that went, and directly we move to 18th century, where we see a huge Eiffel Tower built up. If you look at the differences between 2700 BC structure pyramid and 1000 BC water management system and the 18th, 19th and 20th century buildings, there's a distinct difference that you see. We have moved quite taller. We have saved a lot on the material consumption, and these buildings are equally strong. Do you see a reason? Can you find out a reason? The reason is very simple. The structural engineering started as a profession, or you can say the engineering started as a profession from 18th century. Sometime in 17th century. So from 18th century, you see Eiffel Tower. 18th century itself, there was a very important discovery of concrete. And that is why from 19th century onwards, you see bigger structures. So this is how the tall buildings started to come up. The infrastructure started to become a significant part of human society. And the development started to go into that part of the industry. If you look at the history of the structural engineering in India, you can again look at 2500 BC, where Mohenjo-Daro was built up. Again, a very small city, again, the building blocks with small usage of concrete and zero usage of steel. Then in around 200 BC, Maurya started to build up around 1800 stupas all across India. Again, a very simple structure of the building blocks standing over each other. 12th century, you see Qutub Minar and certain forts, very, very famous forts of Raigad and Sinhudurg, which was built up in the sea. again, the building blocks, like the stones and the bricks that we use without much use of the steel, right? This Howrah Bridge, which is again a steel structure, it's a purely steel structure. The Konkan Railway was built up in the 19th century. The recent developments in India, I think you all are aware, and that is why we all are here, is because the expansion of the real estate in India. So the reflection of this is the World Tower that you see in front of your screen, which is going to be, which was built up to be the tallest residential tower in the world, which was around also the Bandra Worli ceiling, which is another engineering marvel, a bridge through the sea. So the progress that you see is exponential. And we can expect this to continue because we always try to reflect the Western countries like US. And I still believe that we are still 50 years behind these countries, where now US is having more than thousands of tall buildings, which are more than 150 meter tall. And we just started. If you look at the Indian code, Indian structural design codes, they are still developing. So I see a huge future in that also. All that, I believe it is very clear that if you look at the history and moving forward, I believe it's expansive growth that we are looking at. The next slides will help you understand what is definitely the need of the hour and also how to prepare for it. As you guys are aware, the Indian government is very much fond of the infrastructure, I should say. If you look at the road developments, so for any country to develop and for any region, every city to develop, you have to build up the infrastructure. And that is what I think the current government also understood very, very early. And that is why they are going to be putting up so much money in the construction, right? So if you look at the current chart, the demand of India is huge. We're still not meeting up even the 10% of the demand that we have. So we'll require a huge investment of around 50 trillion across the infrastructure by 2022. It's a huge, substantial increase. The opportunity that you see is huge in that sector. Only 24% of the national network in India is only 4-lane. What that means is the 76% is still to be 4-lane. That means a huge construction is coming up in that national highway network of India, right? And what that means is we will have to build up the roads, the bridges, and find out the innovative solutions to build up huge structures and routes. If you look at the government policy currently, it's all supporting the infrastructure. If you look at the initiatives like Housing for All and the Smart City missions, they will definitely drive the growth of the sector. Currently, the 100% FDI is permitted under automatic route across various infrastructures. So when FDI is talked about, we speak about a lot of money getting pouring into the Indian market. Right? And also the investment in the last few years. For example, the infrastructure sector attracts around 14.7 billion across 74 deals in just 1 year. So we're talking about huge amount of money getting poured in. This is with respect to the infrastructure. I'll go to the real estate industry. I will be speaking about also what is the difference between the infra and the real estate industry in a couple of slides next. But for the time being, let's just understand the real estate industry is something where people stay, right? Like the housing, the tall buildings that you see for human occupation. So again, the demand for the residential property has recently been seen surging due to the increased urbanization and rising household income. So if you look at the 10 top cities by population, in they would see at least 3 cities from India. So Delhi, Kolkata, Mumbai, and all these cities have exhausted their area. So all they have to do is go up. When cities try to go up, they try to build up very tall buildings and also the infrastructure that is required for them. For example, the metros. Now look at the metros in the last 10 years. It has grown up significantly, right? So India is among the top 10 price appreciating housing market internationally. So what that means is the housing is still in the huge demand. That is why the housing industry is showing up appreciation in the prices. Again, the attractive opportunities, because if you look at the healthcare, e-commerce and logistics sectors in India, it has grown significantly in last 10 years. And co-living market size across India's top 30 cities is expected to grow more than double in just 5 years. Look at the money that will be required and look at the amount of infrastructure that will be required. Same goes, if you look at the policy of the government, same goes for the real estate industries also. FDI is allowed for the 100% of the township and settlements development projects. Under the Housing for All scheme, 60 million houses will be built. 40 million of these will be rural areas, 20 million in urban areas in just next 2 years. The real estate attracted around $6.6 billion investment in just 2019. Again, a huge, huge amount. And some real estate sector attracted more than $5 billion in private equity inflows, out of which 66% is in commercial real estate. So it's a huge amount of opportunities. The demand is quite significant in the real estate industries right now. And if you look at the market size, currently it's around 10% of the GDP. So if you all are civil engineers, you can take pride in that, in saying that we are almost at, and it is also coming in FDI, right? And if you look at the Department of Promotions of Industry and Internal Trade, the logistics sector in India is growing at a 10.5% annually and expected to become 215 billion. So again, there is a growth. There is a movement happening in this section also. So if you look at the market size, it's huge. If you look at the growth across the years between 2007 to 2016, just by 10 years, it has grown pretty much from 2% to 10% now. You can just expect the same growth to continue in the same thing. I believe any infrastructure, any housing and everything requires a government initiative. And government India understands that. For a development, infrastructure is the main key to it. And that is why a lot of roads have been built. Around $212 billion will be spent in next just 2 years. Indian energy sector is offering huge opportunities over the next 10 years because with the increased growth population, the development of different cities, the movement, the transportation, all will require energy. And that is why we are planning to have around $300 billion of investment in that sector. Again, National Highway Authority of India will be generating a revenue of $14.31 billion through toll and waysides. Again, if you look at the highways, now highways we're saying the National Highway Authority of India will be building up the highways, and across the highways, when the highways are built, the cities are built, because India basically lives around only two things. One is the highway, second is the rivers. So Indian population, if you look at that, is basically situated across the rivers or around the highways. And what that means is with highways getting built, more and more cities will come into picture with certain to develop the transport infrastructure. Communication sector is also growing at the speed, and I'm expecting it will grow more with the current limitations of the COVID and all. And again, Indian Railway, the largest employer in the world, is again receiving a huge amount of money for its development. So we are seeing a huge amount of development in every sector of the infrastructure and real estate. So again, I'm just highlighting certain things of the growth. If you look at the highway industry, it's a 15% growth during the FY 20 years. If you look at the sectors, basic 8 core infrastructure industries, you see steel, cement, and electric going at a very high percentage. What that simply means is the construction is going quite on the faster speed. The trends, if you look at the highway construction in India, has been, if you look at from 2016 to 2019, just in 3 years, it has pretty much doubled, right? Same goes for the electricity generation capacity, because all these things go hand in hand. The infrastructure, they go hand in hand. The same goes for the airports also, because once the city starts to develop, you also have to develop the airports and other transportation. And one such deal I would like to highlight here is the largest deal done by Abu Dhabi Investment Authority and BSPIB of India. They made an investment worth $1.1 billion. So all these things and certain things that are not part of these slides are also the faster metros and bullet trains and everything that you have been hearing about. So all these things require civil engineers, and all these things require structural engineers in particular, because without actual design, nothing will stand. So these are all the developments that we're talking about. And if you look at the road ahead, it's very bright. The setback that we are seeing right now is just a minor setback and maybe the correction in the market. But if you look at the infrastructure sector, it's the biggest focus of government of India right now. They're planning to put up around 1.4 trillion. It's a huge amount in just 5 years. Sustainable development. What are we doing right now is just developing cities and just providing the roads. But sustenance is another thing. Once you build it, you have to sustain it. And to sustain it, you will also require structural engineers. that we will see in the next few slides also. Once you have it, you have to keep on running it, and then running it is also some engineering is required for that also. Amount of money put in railways, and then different countries like India and Japan are collaborating for the India's northeast states and development of those. A certain, if you look at the last point, the real estate is expected to see the rebirth after SEBI has given approval to REIT, which will allow all kind of investors to invest in the real estate market. So what that means is the real estate market. And if you actually look at the statistics, more than a lot of people will require homes. A lot of people will go into building homes, for which again, the structural engineering profession will be required. So all these are very bright pictures, and they will show you why we should look at this as a profession. Moving on, so what are the fields where, so all these money is coming in, where government will be putting up these monies. So these are the fields where the money will be put in, right? So the first and the foremost is the commercial. The commercial markets are basically defined as something which are human occupied, and where people do not stay, they just work, right? So that includes the retail sector, that is the malls and let's say theater, the hospitals, everything. The offices, because almost one third of our time we spent in offices. So all this population going to city will require offices to work also. And certain industrial roof trusses where the manufacturing happens, the storing happens, and assembling and all those. So manufacturing, offices and retail are the three essential parts of. Again, the residential part comes as the second bit. The residential is currently the major contribution in the economy, because everybody requires something. Everybody requires a house. It's one of the basic needs. So the townships, which are the horizontal developments, and the vertical developments. Why I'm talking about these two parts separately is they have different engineering challenges. We'll be looking into those as we move on. In the infrastructure that government typically is interested in are the bridges and the transportation, which includes the road, trails, and metros, and definitely the water retaining structure, because you would want the dams and everything to be built for as a water retaining area. Government is also putting up some money in certain other sectors, which are really interesting, but very very small sectors like nuclear power plants. The space work, the shipping yards, the monuments and parks, and schools, colleges, and other office buildings also. So all these come under the government works, for which the contracting is very particular. We'll talk about that as we go to that slide. And as a structural engineer, we also have to perform certain other services, which include peer review, audit and certification for the existing structure, and even before the structure is built, certain certifications are required. Sometimes the demolitions, it is a really interesting topic. Again, a very small sector, but a very interesting one. And certain government panels. So if you talk about government panels, certainly government required certain expertise to give them the ideas to, and also as the lecturers and certain authorities, right? So the government panels are also there where the structure engineers will be required. So we'll go one by one. Let's look at the commercial sector first. What are the challenges? So when I talk about, okay, I'll go one slide back. So when I talk about all these sectors and all the buildings that are built in each bucket, I will talk about two important parts of the structural engineering. One is the input and another is the output. When I say input is basically in terms of, let's say, a structural engineer is working on designing a building, it would require certain inputs like the loads. Loads could be, let's say, dead load, live load, or maybe wind loads or earthquake loads, or certain unknown loads like dynamic loads. And certain other inputs also, for example, an architect requires something very beautiful to be built up, right? So that sort of input. Sometimes the client will have different requirements. So those sorts of are the inputs, and those are also sometimes very challenging. And the second part of it is the output. When I say output in terms of, if you look at any building or any structure, it can be safely divided into four parts, which is beam, slab being the horizontal members, and the vertical members being columns and walls. So basically all these four can be taken as the output. And all these four will have their own challenges, basis which bucket you choose. If you look at the commercial sector, so let's just look at what come under commercial sector. So commercial is basically retail, where you can see malls, right? And then theaters, then hospitals and schools and other parts of it. So why I have clearly mentioned commercial and why I'm highlighting these is, if you look at malls, for example, you can see large spans. Okay? So every floor of a mall will be different. So when a structural engineer is working on design of these, every floor will be designed separately. Every column will be having different challenges as we go up. So malls will not be very tall, but they'll have huge spans and large heights. What that means is these columns will be slender. They'll have their own challenges. And since mall, every inch is used economically, you will be restrained by the sizes also. You'll be asked to provide the smallest of the sizes. What that means is you might will have to go for, okay, so what are the expertise that will be required in malls is definitely for the large spans. You will be talking about this pre-stressed slabs where the spans can be reduced, and steel structures. So basically, if you go on using concrete, the sizes of the elements will be so huge for these spans, probably the slab will not be of any use to the end user. So what do you want to do if you want to use the steel or trusses, or sometimes the trusses are also used as a beautification of these walls. So all these things are considered as the challenges. Another type of challenge in mall is, let's just say a mall is built. So how typically a real industry, real sector industry work is, there will be a client who will have money and he wants to build something. That something could be a mall, a theater, a hospital, a residential building, anything. So what he says, okay, let me hire an architect. He will give me idea how to. Architect gives him basic of the ideas, but now architects can't be keeping it standing. So what he does, he hires a structural engineer. The structural engineer will provide the basic framing, how the columns and slabs and everything will be placed. So there are different team members also. The third team member would be a mechanical, electrical, and plumbing consultant. And they all will join together, will create certain drawings, and the end product would be a site team working on the site, building up these things. And then the finishing and everything. So, okay, the client has built up the malls with everybody in the team. Very nicely, the mall is built. Now, the end user comes, and the end user could be a commercial, for example, a shop, a Reebok shop, or a bag shop. And what they say is, I want to make certain changes in this space that I'm given. So the client will give them the open space. They will have to do the interiors. And what they do, they create certain openings in the slab. They build up certain new things in that space, which will provide more load, which will put more load on the slabs for which the slab isn't designed. So as a structural engineer, you have to also look at these points. For example, let's just say if you have a large span and I'm putting up a pre-stressed slab. Now I can't have a cut in a pre-stressed slab, because if I cut that slab, the tendons will be breaking up and all the support system will go haywire. So you cannot provide pre-stress in that mall, because now the end user might ask for a cutout. So what you want to do is you want to provide the steel. So all such inputs and all such challenges, you have to look at the day one. So as a professional, you have to look at these challenges which will be coming. The second image that you see in it is a theater. If you look at the theater, look how large span the roof is on the top. There are no columns in between, because any column in the center would kill at least hundreds of chairs. And because it will be obstructing the view. So look at the span of the top of the slab. You can look at the challenges. You can just imagine the challenges for a structural engineer to put up on the roof. So it is very, very challenging as far as the engineering is concerned. Though it does not look very big, it is very, very challenging. Most of the theaters, you would see cantilever slabs popping out. And cantilevers are one of the most dangerous of the structures. They have serviceability issues. After 50 years, you will see large deflections in them, which you did not count it at the day one. So all these things you need to be very worried about. So all these challenges are there. For this, the expertise that you would require as a structural engineer is also very, very particularly, you will want an expertise into pre-stress, the large span structure, the steel structure. So from the field of engineering, probably these are not new words to you. But if you go to the structural engineering particularly, again, the structural engineering is brought into different classifications. And then steel composite sections, the pre-stressing, pre-cast structures are some part of it, right? So commercial, the large spans and the huge heights will definitely be requiring the expertise of a pre-stressed or a steel structural engineer, okay? So the second part of the commercial are the office buildings. Now, office buildings are basically not as challenging as the first part that we saw. These are typically, every floor will be very much same with certain minor variation. The only challenge is they also want column free spaces. So basically, when you see a structure, the outputs are basically your beams, slabs, columns and walls, as we initially highlighted. The challenges in these office buildings are you cannot have beam on the periphery because that will obstruct the view, right? You cannot have core walls in the center because then the office space gets divided into multiple parts. You can't have columns wherever you want it because they will again divert the office space. So with all these challenges, basically the challenge is on the output front. Now the output is all these four elements that we spoke about. And that is why the challenges is how to minimize the sizes, where to place the columns, and how to optimize the vertical elements also. Now again, in the office buildings, you would see large spans because you want the column-free spaces. Again, you would want the construction to be faster. So you will have to see whether you want to use concrete, which requires minimum, let's say, 28 days to gain its full strength, or you want to use steel, which can be, you know, fast. You can assemble the things up and then go up. Faster construction is achieved by doing that also. Now, flat slab are required because you want a better height. Office buildings typically have larger heights, let's say 4.2 meter times 4.2, 4.5 meters. And what happens is now the Indian code does not allow you to do anything that you want, which is very common to pretty much all the sectors. But let's just say Indian code will bind you with certain limitations. For example, if you are in zone 3, you will not be able to go with flat slab because Indian code 1893 does not allow you to do that. And then you have to find out innovative solutions how to tackle those. You have to go into the details of the intent of the code, why code is saying that. And if there is any way we can keep the intent intact and still work out what the client wants, right? So these are the different challenges for the office building.